Welcome to another episode of That's Some Crazy Shit with Kelly and James. My name is Kelly.
And I'm James.
Hi, James.
What's up, my sister?
So I got a question for you.
All right, go.
What do you know about pleasure?
What do I know about pleasure?
Pleasure.
Pleasure feels pleasure. Pleasure feels good.
It does feel good. Anyway, James, why we're talking about this, I want to tell you about this guest. This guest, her whole thing is pleasure. And she means sexual pleasure, all types of pleasure. And I know when people think of pleasure, they think of sex, but she's talking.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
That just scared me. She's talking like the next level. She's talking like mind-altering, you know, relationships that you can have in your life, in your business, in your relationships, and yes, in your sex life. She calls herself the world's number one muse.
Oh, well, right on. You know what? As a guy, I'm excited to hear what she has to say.
Her name is Marianne St. Clair, and she is here today, James, to talk to us all about pleasure. And I am excited to talk to her because we're going to learn all about pleasure. And that pleasure can be so low, or it can be with a friend.
Right on.
Are you ready?
I am ready. Let's do it.
All right. Welcome to the podcast. The world's number one muse, Marianne St. Clair. Marianne, thank you so much for joining us today on That's Some Crazy Shit. Welcome.
Thank you for having me. Both of you, I'm excited for our discussion today.
Me too.
I am also, yeah.
Me too. So, you know, let's just cut to the chase and let's just tell the listeners what it is that you do, like why you're with us today. What crazy shit have you brought for us?
Let's just talk about sex. Let's just get it right out there. Let's get it out in the open. Let's talk about the two things that people have a really hard time talking about, and that's sex and money. And I bring both of them together to see how we can have better sex and bigger profits in all areas of our life. So
I love it. Yeah.
So are you saying that good sex brings more money?
I'm saying good, connected, fulfilled sex where you bring there's an aliveness running through your body. There's a aliveness that is the most potent energy. And when you can take it, use that, and focus it in a way, brings lots more money.
Wow. All right. So I know that you've got a master class that you're doing and teaching this. So I've always wondered, like, how do you teach this stuff?
So, first of all, most people, would you say, operate from here up? Most people are in their heads. They're thinking their way through. They're thinking their way in their, how they can, I call it the doingness of life. They're in the doingness, the rat race. And so, in my masterclass, I first teach all about pleasure, how to come back into our bodies and live a full, embodied, multi-sensory, multi-dimensional being rather than living from here up. So we do exercises. We do fun exercises where we begin to feel again and feel the sensations and what it feels like to, when you can imagine tasting like chocolate and how you can bring yourself back into your body with that feeling of, aliveness, that's something you really bring pleasure. Because here's the thing, where were we taught about pleasure? Where were you in your life ever taught about this thing called pleasure? You were taught maybe how not to have pleasure, right?
Yeah. It's kind of a taboo thing.
It's shame, a lot of shame.
Yeah.
So guess what? Pleasure is a force that runs through you. It's an invisible force, kind of like the wind or gravity. You don't know about it, but if you suppress it and you don't tap into it, guess what? you are like missing out on, you're constricting this most viable energy that you have and you can use.
So how did you find your way into this, Marianne?
I went into burnout. I've been a coach for 26 years, but even as being a coach, until I really went into my body and until I really started bringing my own pleasures alive, I was seeking things externally to bring me fulfillment. And it was really, I had to come home to my body and what felt good. And through this process, if you saw a picture of me from 10 years ago, I looked like a little old granny sitting on a front porch. I was dead. I was half dead. Seriously. I really was physically, mentally, emotionally bankrupt. And now it's like, I feel like I've got that pep in my step. I'm turning 60 next week.
Wow.
Congratulations. Happy birthday.
Yes, congratulations and happy birthday. You look fantastic.
Yeah. When you talk about being the grandma on the porch, I'm like, I can't see it. Sorry, Marianne. Looking at you now.
I've got two grandbabies, and I'm telling you that it's when you make pleasure a priority in your life, and I don't mean just sex. I mean all the things. It's a full spectrum, and it's a full spectrum within us. And it's each individualized. What brings me pleasure isn't going to bring you pleasure, but we may have some similarities. But it's a completely an individual process of discovery within each one of us, and then building upon that and increasing the capacity is what you get here. You know, this full aliveness and ooh-la-la that lives within me. I call it my lusciousness.
I like it, lusciousness.
So is the master class geared toward men and women?
It is. It's both men and women. I would say it's generally for leaders. So a leader could be somebody leading their family. It doesn't have to be, you know, just that CEO. So I go from the leader who's leading her life, and maybe it's her family that is, and she's trying to run a side hustle, all the way to the corporate C-suite, because it's for everybody. We weren't taught pleasure. We weren't taught how to use it.
No, we really weren't.
And so have you noticed that when you're teaching pleasure or trying to get the concept out there, that a lot of people have a hard time kind of grasping that whole concept of pleasure? Like, how do I do that? That's what I think of. What do you mean? Because there's lots of things that I like. I don't know. Do they necessarily give me pleasure? Do you know what I'm saying? So what things do you do outside of sex that would bring you, that you would say would be something that would bring you pleasure? Am I making sense, Marianne?
Absolutely. And it's such a good question, because we weren't taught, or we weren't exposed. Different families have a different origin of upbringing, and whether or not you also had, you know, different types of religious upbringing can have a whole different flair of what we were exposed to. And so when we were taught that the word pleasure just meant sex, and it's something that you only do when you're in that, you know, place of behind closed doors. But pleasure is what makes you feel good, what makes you feel alive. So say, for instance, if you don't begin to come into your body, you're not in your felt senses, you're not in the way that you can judge whether or not something feels good or doesn't. So first you have to come into the body. And then it goes all the way from, oh my gosh, does a steak feel like something that if you put a bite of a big juicy piece of steak, would that bring you into this feeling of, oh my gosh, if you slowed down and you put that piece of steak in there and you felt it in your mouth and then you smelled it, rather than just making food something that we inhale. And, you know, it's, we're not present to our pleasure. We're not present to what brings us joy, what brings us, and the way you can start feeling it in your life, Kelly, is it'll make you feel open. It'll make you feel more light and enlivened. And when something doesn't bring you pleasure, it'll weigh you down. It'll constrict you. It'll be, if you've heard of kinesiology, you know, have either of you heard of kinesiology?
Is that the movement?
It's, kinesiology is when you can muscle test whether or not something is good for you or something is bad. Because our heads will lie to us, but our body manifests.
It's true, man. My head has told me a lot of bad things in the past.
And that's, I guess, where that saying comes from, go with your gut.
Right?
Yeah, in our gut, even, you know, the gut and the heart, but think about it. We've got all these neuroreceptors on our skin. We've got, our heart will start pulsing and getting faster, or you may have some, you know, different sensations on your shoulders. But when you can start understanding and reading what your body is telling you, oh my gosh, it's game changer.
Go ahead, Marian.
No, then just listening to this monkey mind that's like got programming that is pretty obsolete. It needs to be, the hard drive needs to be wiped clean and
to start from fresh.
Right?
Wow.
You know, it, listening to you describe it, look, you know, looking back, there are things in my life that now I can say do bring me pleasure, you know. And it's not necessarily physical either, you know? So that's interesting. I don't think people really, like you said, sit back and really think, you know, what brings me pleasure? What simple things just bring me pleasure?
There's simple pleasures. There's guilty pleasures. There are pleasures that we should not even engage in. Like, you know, empty sex. There's people who will just do sex with somebody out of obligation because they went on a date and they think, oh my gosh, you know, I need to go ahead. Rather than feeling, is this something that I want to do? Is this something that makes me feel good? Is this something, and then walk away if it doesn't?
Yeah, I agree with that 100%. I agree.
But it can be, Kelly, it can be simple as reading a book.
Yeah. You know, when you think about pleasure, like what you were saying, James, you know, what brings me pleasure is gardening. Once I get in the garden, and I'm a barefoot gardener at that. So I can be in there for hours.
Right. And it becomes timeless.
Yes.
It becomes like when you were a kid, because the two things I'm passionate about are pleasure and play. And I think if we have pleasure and play every day, then life just becomes this wonderful playground for us to play in. You know, instead of this hard place where we got to grind and we got to do, we forgot the things that really can just give us a sense of adventure, of wonder, of curiosity when we take on these childlike qualities, not childish qualities, but the childlike ones of play. And then we learn what makes us feel good, what doesn't, and listen to the no and listen to the yes, life becomes just magical to me.
Marianne, do you have a certain demographic that comes to you? Do you find older people are coming to you now because they're ready to experience pleasure, or are the young coming to you because they want to experience pleasure longer, or is there a certain demographic?
I think I have two. You know, I definitely have both men and women. I think the baby boomers who are retiring, who have, you know, built their ladder of success, they've already climbed it. They're in that place and they know something's missing. They don't know what it is, but there's something more, and they can't quite find it, because their same mind that they've been working with all these years doesn't know how to go into the being state. You kind of hear some people, like actors or like President Bush, they're taking up painting, and they're taking up, you know, all these other forms of creativity that is now present for them. And what I do is help them explore that and find them.
Hmm.
And then there's the other ones that are the climbing ones, the climbing professionals, the climbing. They are getting burnt out, and burnout is just epic in our society these days. And so what I really do is help them find this new fuel and help them. I call, you know, pleasure is a mindset shift. From work, 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 to adding more pleasure can actually give you more fuel to do the things that you want to do in life. You know, more money, better sex, you know, rather than chasing empty sex and chasing money. We create it by using the fuel of pleasure.
I like that you create it, you don't chase it. I like that.
So, Marianne, there is a lot of classes out there and courses out there, and people are always, you know, teaching, and you're a coach, you've been doing this a long time. But the big question isn't so much the learning, it's the doing after we've had the class, right? And incorporating these things into our lives so that we can benefit. So what's an easy way to start incorporating these things into your life that won't feel like a task? I think a lot of people go to courses, and then when it comes to doing, they feel like it's a task, or now it's just something that I have to do, or, and then so you don't do it, you know, you don't learn. So how can you help us incorporate these things where it feels almost like second nature?
Becomes habit.
Yes, and that's so good, because I don't want this to be another thing on your to-do list. This is a way of living. This is a way of being. It is not a way of doing. And that's the key distinction for this, okay? Living a pleasure-filled life and a pleasure-full life is different than trying to figure out how I'm gonna have pleasure, okay? So you do a mindset shift into, is this podcast something that, you know, brings me pleasure? And obviously it does, because you all do it over and over again.
No. We keep coming back, yeah.
Right. So, but if it wasn't, it would be like, excuse me, but you know what I mean. So, it's a way of what lens am I looking at my life through? And I want you to start looking at through the lens of pleasure. Is this bringing me more joy? Is this bringing me alive? Does it make me feel good? Does it make me feel inspired to do something more? If it doesn't, you're not feeling that connection in your relationships with people, if it doesn't feel good, it's time to exit, not do it. It's time to do something else.
That's funny that you say that, because me and James just had this conversation. Talk about synchronicities. And I told him that my thing for this year was, if it doesn't make you feel good, why are you doing it?
Yes.
And it's kind of that simple, but sometimes it's like, yeah, why am I doing this?
Yeah. Sometimes you do it just, you think like obligation, like, you know,
or guilt.
Or guilt, yeah.
Or shame.
Or shame. Yeah.
You know, all of those things that we feel that are extrinsically driving us. Things from the outside, people pleasing, doing for others, making, living for somebody else's view of how I should be living. And what I find a lot of times with a lot of my clients are, their life looks great on the outside. They're married, they've got the great career, you know, they're making the money, their kids are doing things, that, you know, having the extracurricular, and they may have two homes, but there's something missing. And that's them. They need to come home to them. They need to find the things that are most important to them.
I think that gets lost so much in the everyday shuffle, really, you know.
Yeah.
It's funny.
So how long is the masterclass?
The masterclass is 90 minutes. I hold it weekly. We do exercises. We really dive into, you know, what your life looks like now and what it could look like. Because I believe life should be an orgasmic adventure. You know, it should feel really good.
It's true.
When you have that orgasm, it should feel amazing. Life should feel like that. It shouldn't feel like,
I agree.
Covers over my head and just go back and hide.
I would agree. So once you take the master class, is there any type of like follow-up or any other types of things that you offer as a coach once somebody's taken the class and ways to help kind of maybe keep somebody motivated?
Yes. I have 3 tiers to my program. And, you know, for someone who wants to come in and really dive into this and get deeper, they can work with me one-on-one. And I offer a VIP day where we spend a full day and we really get into your pleasure and look at your dreams and desires. And I come to you as a muse to find those things inside of you rather than the coach telling you what to do. I help, you know, find those things by shining light as the muse. So there's a 4-week intro program that they can begin and really learn. They will come out of the intro program having tools that they can use to move forward and go forward. It's not like it doesn't have just some concepts. It has actual life-changing exercises and things. And then they work with me one-on-one in that also. And then there's more, there's like a 3- and a 6-month program that they can do also.
Wow.
Where we get this fully embodied, where we, you know, really take this into a life's practice.
Marianne, have you ever run into someone who just couldn't get past the shame or the guilt for whatever reason to let themselves experience pleasure?
No. No, because I feel that it's something that is intrinsically built into us. We all want to feel joy. We all want to feel happiness. And it's within us. It's just been buried, or there's been traumas, or I do an exercise called the Dirty Little Lies, where, I want you to excavate those things that are the barriers, beliefs, and bullshit that are keeping you from this, keeping you from experiencing, you know, a pleasurable life. And that's the first step, is the turn off, is to find those things and then begin to turn them off. And then the next is tune in to your pleasure, tune in to your body, tune in to your own, I call it lusciousness.
I like that word.
So in the beginning, when we first started, you had mentioned sex. So is teaching or helping someone learn how to pleasure themselves, is that part of the program too? Because that's where a lot of, I think, the shame comes in for women, and masturbating and knowing that that's okay. And even saying the word masturbation for women, it just sounds so odd than it does like for men. It's just so much more accepted, right? So is that part of the program
not
too?
Not really.
Well,
not
I mean, really, but you see, yeah, it is, because masturbation is a joke in movies for men. It's not really a joke
but just from a man's perspective.
Ah, okay, James.
You know,
from a woman's perspective, it seems like it's more acceptable for you than it would be for me.
It has both, because I know men are taught, get your hand off of that. That's not good. Right. You know, don't do that. That's bad. you know, so they have shame around it also. Have they explored? Yes, more than women. Are there all kinds of things in movies and jokes and that make it more acceptable and outwardly okay? Yes. But as far as women, we have been really suppressed. Sexual for men and women has been in our face in advertising and the way that in movies and everything. But there's this sexual tension because everything we were taught was taught, it's bad, it's wrong, don't do it. You know, you shouldn't be doing that unless you're in a relationship, unless you're married, and unless... And then by the time you get, if somebody saved themselves for that relationship, who taught you how to do it other than maybe in the backseat of a car or on a football field or something?
Right.
Or porn.
Or your friends, yeah.
Your friends.
And then it's like, get in there, get it. You know, we're like, rah, rah, rah. It's like, so nobody wants to, who wants to continue sex as a woman? A woman really needs to open. She needs to feel safe. She needs to feel good. And if that doesn't happen, it's like, oh, she's just doing it because she's supposed to. And then it's like, you know, dry pussy, dry, you know. It's like, you don't want to do it. It hurts. It's painful. But I encourage you that there is this whole... When you begin, that's tune in. When you begin to tune into your body, when you begin to tune into what makes you feel good, how can you communicate it to anybody if you don't know it yourself?
Right.
Yeah. Harder exploring. How do you know if light touch feels good? It may feel like needles on a chalkboard to somebody, but it really firm pressure might feel amazing to somebody else. But if you don't know these things, if you're not willing to say, ooh, I want to get in there, I want to feel what makes my body feel good, and I want to know what turns my pussy on, and we're beginning to reclaim our bodies and reclaim that and get rid of the shame and get rid of that guilt, because you know what? Selfishness and exploring my body is, I'm all for it. It's like, but they're okay. Now wait a second. So if you, there goes, I go the full gamut, right? From just beginning to tune into your body all the way to sexual transmutation. There's when it gets really fun. When you can take your sexual energy and you can transmute it into, because it's creativity. It's pure creativity. Sexual energy. And so when you don't just masturbate and just let that energy explode and go out, but when you can masturbate and then you can cultivate that energy and you can maybe not have that ejaculation, but bring it up into your heart and then bring it up into your third eye and your imagination and then really send that out to an intention, that's when it gets fun.
That's sex magic.
That's sex magic.
That is sex magic.
That's sex magic. And that's what we're in Think and Grow Rich. You know, that's what
Thank you. That is the name of the book. Who wrote that book?
Napoleon Hill.
Thank you.
Think and Grow Rich, chapter 11. He talks about sexual transmutation.
Yes, he does.
But do you know 90? Okay, did either one of you know? Do you know how to do that? Do you know how to sexually transmute your... Okay.
No,
not me. So probably 90% of the business owners and entrepreneurs and successful, you know, CEOs have read that book. But when I pull them, not many people know what that is. They read over it, but they're not using it.
I remember reading that in the book, and I could never remember what book it was, but I remember somebody talking about the ability to do that. So thank you for bringing that up.
Yes, and it is sex magic. It is taking and using that energy for we create babies, we create worlds, we create, you know, sexual energy is hope. And when utilized, you can create anything.
That is true. That is true.
Don't masturbate and put it out there because you're wasting it.
Wow.
Everything with an intent.
Right. You're wasting your vital life.
And that's how we could say that, James.
That's heavy. I mean,
that's some crazy shit.
Where we grew up, it was very taboo. Sex was very taboo. The culture, the religion, everything around
us. You had sex for one reason, and that was to procreate.
Yeah.
That was the only reason why you would ever think about how. You didn't have it for pleasure. You know, we're not animals. You know, that's what we were taught. You have it for procreation.
Yeah, and everything else was bad.
Everything else was bad.
And I'm here to tell you, let's make all that bad good.
Let's do it. Absolutely.
I'm ready. After all these years.
So, Marianne, if somebody was interested in learning more about the masterclass, how do they reach you?
I'm on all social medias as Marianne St. Clair, and I think you'll probably put it in the show notes. And that's Marianne St. Clair is spelled with an I. Marianne is M-A-R-I-A-N. But the masterclass is bizofpleasure.com/masterclass. And it's life-changing.
Wow.
Sounds like it. It does.
Marianne, thank you so much for coming on and sharing with us. I thought it was absolutely fascinating. Thank you.
I learned a lot.
You're welcome. Yeah. Thank you for having me.
You know what, Cal? I have to say, I think we're reaching a different level with our guests.
Right? Wasn't she great?
You know, I mean, you know, the paranormal, that's all cool and stuff, you know, but this is a different level, you know.
This is crazy shit too.
Yeah, and it's not, like I say this, as a guy, you know, I think it's nice to want to be able to have pleasure yourself, but pleasure your partner too. You know, we're getting to the age, man, where we don't have a whole lot of years left to not be having as much pleasure as we can. And I wish she was around when I was younger and I wasn't so ashamed to be pleasuring myself.
And the nice thing about it is that she's got this master class that you can go to. Is it the business of pleasure or the pleasure of business? At any rate, the information will be in the podcast description. So go check out her master class. She is talking about having more money, more sex, more success, more love, more achievements, more quality time. And all of that, and pleasure too. I have never been excited for a guest as I am about this one because I liked everything that she said. And I'm going to say it. Pussy power. Yep.
Well, see, that's the thing, my friend. We talked about after we stopped talking, we talked about that. Save that for next time when she comes on.
She's coming back and we're talking about it because it's some crazy shit. It's some real shit. And it's really sad that we don't talk about it, women are shamed. That's a whole nother subject for a whole nother time.
But you know what? We've gone to a different level, my friend, with this. And sex magic is all I got to say.
Oh, well, you know what? That was what I was going to think about for random bullshit because I wanted to give you my theory on the Kardashians and sex magic. Are you ready to hear my theory? This is my random bullshit. And I rarely start random bullshit, but this is my theory. Mind you, people, it is just simply Kelly's theory. I'm throwing it out there. So the Kardashians have dated many, many dudes. They've left many, many dudes broken, careers gone, But every time they do, every time they get with the dude and they use him, and you know, for a little while the dude's elevated, they're this power couple, something happens, dude breaks down, becomes broken, but the girls always seem to prosper and even elevate themselves a little bit from after said relationship. So after thinking about this, my theory is that the Kardashians are witches and that they've been using sex magic on all of these dudes. And once they suck the essence from all of them, or, you know, one by one, they have left them broken where their careers have ended. Some of them, we don't even remember their names. Like I asked you the last time, who was the basketball player back in the day that Kim Kardashian was with?
Well, there's, and the only reason I know this is because he played here for the Jazz. His name was Chris Humphries. But then her sister went out with another basketball player.
And what happened to him?
Odom?
Yeah, what happened to Lamar?
Oh, God, he's
done.
Some strip club and had cocaine possession. It was downhill.
Other dudes that they've been with, broken, done. Done. They've like sucked the essence out of them. Their careers are over. Kanye, crazy as fuck. Sorry, just putting it out there. But I don't think he was that crazy until he got with Kim. I'm sorry. And now look at him. I'm telling you, there's something there.
Well, and it's funny because when we talked about this, and I don't remember what I was doing, but I was reading something. They showed an old picture of them. And you know what? They fucking look like totally different. Not like me and you when we were 12 and now we're not. Like me and you when we were 12 and now we're someone else.
Like me and you if we would have been... maybe me and you, if we would have maybe sold our soul, done some type of ritual to give us youth or beauty or whatever. I'm just saying, mind you, it's just a theory. I don't want to offend anybody if you're a fan of the Kardashians, but they're witches. I'm just saying. Okay, that's all I got for random bullshit.
Wow.
Just saying.
You know what?
They've left many
What's the dude? See, I don't even know his name now. What's the last dude that Kim went out with?
Pete Davidson.
And he left Saturday Night, didn't he?
Yep. He's no longer a member on Saturday Night Live, which is where he got his notoriety. Like I was telling you, he, you know, his thing was he's, you know, the youngest cast member of Saturday Night Live. Dad died in 9/11 as a firefighter. You know, I mean, he was coming up, he's left, he dated her, I guess they're no longer dating. Is my theory true? We can only know if his career now tanks all of a sudden, then yeah. And I feel like she went with him because he was young and she needed some of that young essence because Kim's getting older. She's getting older. Right? So I need young.
Oh, so the older she gets, the younger of essence.
That young essence to keep me young. So that's why she went young. She went young and he was the perfect victim. So yeah. And then when she's done with him, when she's got all the essence that she needs, and we'll see what happens to his career. See if my theory pans out. I'm just saying. You know, sex magic is a real thing.
It is a real thing. We just talked about
and,
that.
And Kim Kardashian made her career off of what? A sex tape. I'm telling you, there's something to my theory. That's all I'm saying. Huh. All of them.
Interesting.
And
oh my gosh! And what's his name?
Who?
Well, Bruce.
Oh, well.
He was so enthralled with the power of pussy, he got his own.
Yeah, that's how powerful it is. It turned him into a woman. That shit was so powerful.
You know, and I have to agree. Pussy's powerful. I'm not going to sit and lie to you.
And so if you can take that and like drain somebody's essence and their life force, and you know, you just kind of step over them, you know, and you're on to the next one. And every time that happens, you're elevated a little bit more. you're more famous, you're more richer. But the dude is like broken and fucking pitiless and crazy and left babbling somewhere. Seriously? All of them?
You're just saying. This sounds kind of like a book or a movie.
Does sound like a movie, doesn't it?
But you know the scary thing is?
What?
It's not.
Yeah. Isn't that what they say? Life imitates fiction, or fiction imitates life, or life imitates art, or whatever.
Yeah, life imitates art.
I'm just saying. So that is my random bullshit. Thank you. Thank you very much. You can get us on social. Hey, we're going to wrap this up because we could talk about this all day. Anyway, that's the theory. That's random bullshit, James. If you, if you want, you can get us on social media. We're on Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, and Twitter. And you can also check out the podcast on YouTube. Next week, James, we're going to have another equally cool guest. And definitely Marianne is going to come back. And we're going to talk about some other crazy shit that's not paranormal, that's real shit. And to wrap up, Kardashians are witches. Okay.
Well, on that note, then, keep your minds open, people.